Thank you for all that you do. Listen, go ahead and grab your Bible, grab your app on your phone, whatever it is. We're getting ready to get into the Word of God. In case you missed it, I had to switch it up today because this Word is going to get you active. Remember, this life that we live, the Christian life, it's a marathon. It's not a sprint. So I put on some workout gear. We're getting ready to work it out in the Word of the Lord. Amen. But listen, y'all already know this spot. It's not the best spot for me to preach this word today, so I'm inviting you to come with me so we can get what God has for us. Let's go.
What's good, fam? It's Pastor Brian. I'm here at the perfect location for the message God has given for me to share with us today. I'm here at the Shenley Oval, and all around us, there are all kinds of sports being played. There are folks that came out for a relaxing walk. There are folks who are hitting the track, soccer games, tennis matches. People are playing volleyball. Some folks around there are playing frisbee golf. All of that is happening here at the Oval, and it's a perfect location for the word that God has for us. But before I get started, I need to take a lap, so let's go.
I'm not perfect, no, I'm not ashamed to confess. I just want you to see that I'm trying, and know it's not a game. Ain't gonna lose no sleep over what people say.
You got me living my life. Ah, you ain't giving me my life. Nah, you can't tell me what's right.
Ah. All right, let's get back into this word. Before I took off for my run, family, I did a little bit of stretching, and then I started off slow. I had a nice, smooth pace, and then as I got faster, I picked up some momentum until finally I hit my stride. That stride is that moment where I'm making significant progress, and I'm moving at about how fast I would move two steps at a time. That stride allowed me to be at a comfortable pace to work my way around this track in a successful way. As we come today to talk about the decade between 50 and 60, that's the word for the decade. But I want you to understand, I'm not just speaking to that age range alone. The word that God has given me is for anybody, no matter what age range you're in, I believe this word is going to hit home. You see, when we talked about our teenage years, we talked about self-discovery. Then in our 20s, the conversation was about survival. How can I make it? In our 30s, the convo was about success. And y'all remember, we said we wanted to have good success. And then last week in our 40s, we talked about significance. Well, today, we're going to talk about hitting our stride. And I believe that's the word for all of us, no matter what age range you're in, is that God wants you to hit your stride. In fact, that's the title of my message today. I'm about to hit my stride. Somebody, type that in the comments. If you got somebody around you, turn to your neighbor and tell them, I'm about to hit my stride. Remember, this is for all age ranges, but I want you in your 50s to know that you are hitting your stride. But even if you're in your 20s, your 30s, your 40s, I believe prophetically that God may be speaking to you today that you are about to hit your stride. Well, what do you mean, Pastor? Everything in the world is slowing down, and the virus is having an impact, and racial injustice are slowing us down. What do you mean? Well, even while everything else is slowing down around you, I believe that God is still saying that you are about to hit your stride. I wonder if anybody is willing to receive that today. You're getting ready to get into a place where you are effective, where you are consistent, where you are moving at a pace that makes progress and that impacts others around you. I'm about, look, I don't even know about you. I might have to preach to myself. I hear the Lord saying, I'm about to hit my stride. I believe that's God's word for us today. If we would lean in and hear what the Lord has to say, He'll give us some significant insight. Author Bob Beale states that when somebody reaches the age of 50, oftentimes the question that looms large is, am I over the hill? are my best years behind me. But he argues that this is the decade where many things begin to come together, where you begin to have a significant impact, not only in your own life, but on the lives of others. You're even more settled in how you operate. You know yourself. You know what you know, and you know what you don't know. And in fact, you're hitting your stride. Some of the opportunities that you've been working your whole life for, those doorways are now opening. Those opportunities are now available, and you are hitting your stride. For some folks, the kids are finally out of the house. Somebody ought to say amen right there, even though they're still asking for money. But you are hitting your stride. And listen, if this is not where you are, I dare you to speak it over yourself. You see, somebody watching might be saying right now, you know what? I'm in a rough season. Pastor ain't talking to me today. I'm not about to hit my stride. In fact, I'm going downhill. I'm in a rough place, and I'm not sure how long I'm going to make it. I dare you. In fact, I implore you to speak this word over yourself. I'm about to hit my stride. Regardless, family, of your age range, you are about to hit your stride. You're getting traction, you're getting clarity, the doors are opening, connections are forming, and atmospheres are shifting. You are about to hit your stride. I need a few folks in the chat just to say, I receive that. I receive it. I hear the Lord speaking to me. You are about to hit your stride. As we dive into this conversation today, the Lord leads us to a biblical character by the name of Elijah. It's a prophet named Elijah that I want to talk about today. But before I talk about the prophet Elijah, I want to talk about another Elijah, an Elijah McClain, and a Breonna Taylor, and a Ahmaud Arbery, a George Floyd, an Antoine Rose, and Amari Thompson, and the names and the list goes on and on of those who were never able to hit their stride because their lives were taken by an unjust system, a system that was never designed to treat all people equally. They never hit their stride because the broken system, in fact, nope, the system isn't broken. It was designed this way. And so I want to take a moment to recognize anytime we're talking about hitting our strides, we have to take into account how we can empower and inspire others to hit theirs and how we can change systems that keep us from reaching our potential. Elijah, the biblical prophet, is hitting his stride. Elijah has been called as a prophet by God. He has served the people of God. He has been called to prophesy in many different circumstances. He was called to prophesy that there would be no rain in the land. And in fact, at his word, it didn't rain. He was called to prophesy to a woman who was down to her last dollars and cents. He spoke the word of God over her, and what she had never ran out. Elijah, this man of God, performed and witnessed the miracles of God. God sent him. He sent ravens to him to feed him breakfast and dinner. That was the move of God in this man's life. And Elijah, he called down fire from heaven as he defeated the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. All of this, I'm telling you, family, as a reminder that Elijah was hitting his stride. And when we find him today, guess what he's doing? He's taking a lap. He's running around the track. We find him, family, running. The Bible declares that God has brought a drought on the land. And God told Elijah, I'm only going to send rain at your word. So he finally tells Elijah, rain is coming. And Elijah goes to meet the king, King Ahab. And Elijah tells the king, rain is coming. The king gets into his chariot, stay with me, and he begins to ride away from the rain. And that's where we pick up the scripture in 1 Kings chapter 18. You can turn there with me. The words are going to appear on the screen. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 46. We can begin at verse 45. Listen to what the scripture says. It says, meanwhile, the sky grew black. The wind rose and a heavy rain started falling. Ahab rode off to Jezreel. He's riding off. Watch this. Verse 46. The power of the Lord came on Elijah, and tucking his cloak into his belt, he ran ahead of Ahab all the way to Jezreel. Did y'all catch that? Ahab is riding in a chariot with horses, and he heads off to a place called Jezreel. Elijah has the power of the Lord come upon him. He tucks his cloak into his belt, and he breaks off running. As he is running, he hits his stride. But this is a supernatural stride, because the Bible says that he runs ahead of Ahab all the way to Jezreel. Because of, watch this, the power that the Lord has upon him, he moves faster than he should have. I want to speak to somebody today. I believe that God has a spirit of acceleration in your life. Again, I know everything else is slowing down around you, but there is a moment, there is a season where God is getting ready to accelerate some things in your life. There are some things that you have been waiting on, and God says, this is a season of acceleration. I don't know who this is for, but even in the middle of this pandemic, God is getting ready to accelerate your business. He's getting ready to accelerate your understanding. He's getting ready to accelerate your insight. He's getting ready to accelerate your children in this season. Why? Because there is an anointing on you for such a time as this. Elijah, he blows our minds because he tucks his cloak into his belt and he runs ahead of Ahab all the way to Jezreel. This is a powerful illustration of what happens when somebody is hitting their stride. But author Bob Beale, he gives us some wisdom and some warning about what to do when you're hitting your stride. In fact, family, there are some things in life and in this world that can strain our stride, that can derail our development, that can pause our progress. So if we're not careful, we'll have to break our stride. We'll lose our effectiveness in the season where God wanted to use us the most. So I want to lift up three things that can strain your stride. The first thing that can strain your stride, family, and we're going to see it in the text, is fog. Fog, yeah. You know, when the sky shifts and a level of atmosphere comes down and blocks your visibility, it gets foggy outside. One time my wife and I were driving to Philadelphia to visit my brother and his wife. And we rode there on the turnpike, had a great trip, no incident. On the way back, we were having a good ride. It was an evening ride, and all of a sudden, all of this fog began to appear. As the fog began to appear, visibility decreased. We could no longer see that far in front of us. And all of a sudden, we had to slow down to a creeping pace. You see, what happens when fog sets in is your stride has to break. And the fog that we experienced was a physical fog, but I want to argue today that sometimes we can also experience a mental fog. Have you ever been trying to process or think through something and you were just at a place where you couldn't think through clearly? I believe the situation of Elijah gives us some insight even into the kind of fog that we can run into. As we turn to chapter 19 in 1 Kings, we begin to see Elijah, who was running, he runs into an experience of fog. Let me grab the word. I need to open this thing back up for us. The Bible says in 1 Kings 19, verse 1, that now Ahab, the king, told his wife Jezebel, y'all remember that name, Jezebel, he told her everything Elijah had done, and how Elijah had been killing the false prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger and said this, May the gods deal with me ever so severely if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life, Elijah, like one of them. She said, Elijah, I'm gonna kill you. Now, this is Elijah, one of the greatest prophets that ever lived. I just went down his resume of what God had been doing through him. I just told you about how Elijah was hitting his stride, but don't miss it, family. Fog can make you break your stride and walk away from where God has you. Verse 3 in 1 Kings 19, it says, Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. My God. The man of God who was just running fast by the power of the Lord that had come over him, and he had overtaken a chariot because he was so tuned in with God, now is running for his life. And this fog has set in, which has now caused him to break his stride. Family, I got to tell somebody today, don't allow foggy thinking or foggy practices to set into your life and cause you to break stride. You've got to remain in that place of moving and meditating, of reaching and resting, so that you can be in a space where you can always hear God's voice and always be in your stride. God says to somebody today, I want you to be in your stride in this season. Don't let the fog slow you down.
The Bible says Elijah was afraid, ran for his life, and went a day's journey into the desert.
You see, sometimes when fog comes upon us, when we're in difficult circumstances or scenarios, we can despair. We lose focus, and we end up in a place that we never planned to be. So here is Elijah, one of the greatest prophets to ever live, hiding in the desert because he ran into the fog. The fog, family, is trying to slow down your stride. The fog is trying to derail your development. The fog is trying to keep you from where God would have you to be. And so if you're going to hit your stride in this season, be mindful of the fog. How do you then ward off the fog? You and I have to stay in His Word. We have to meditate on it day and night. We have to spend time in prayer and fasting. We have to spend time in fellowship with other believers. We have to make sure that we have that proper rotation of reaching and resting, because it's in those times that we're able to find strength in God and ward off the fog that's trying to take us under. Watch me now. Elijah runs into the fog, and the fog slows him down. And part of what happens when the fog slows us down is it actually takes us more energy to operate. Listen, my wife and I, remember we were on that car ride coming back to Pittsburgh from Philly. And as we're driving, that fog settled in. Now, when we got on the road, I was feeling good. I had all kind of energy. I was ready to roll. I was like, look, we're going to hit this road. We're going to make it back in no time. And then the fog set in. And when the fog set in and we had to slow down, visibility was poor. All of the sudden, I got tired. All of the sudden, my reflexes weren't as fast. All of the sudden, I wasn't focused as much anymore. And the fog led to fatigue. That's the second thing that you and I must be mindful of if we're hitting our stride, or if we recognize that we're about to hit our stride. We've got to be mindful that fog can lead to fatigue, that foggy thinking can lead to fatigue in the way that we operate. And God says, I never designed you to be in that kind of space of fatigue where you can no longer function in who I called you to be and what I called you to do. Have you ever been there where things are just so unclear, where things are so foggy, where all you can do is lay down? All you can do is get in the bed, lay on the couch, watch Netflix all day long, because that fog leads to fatigue. We see it in Elijah as he takes this day's journey into the wilderness. Not only now is his mind foggy, but his body begins to exhibit what first showed up in his mind. Family, this is why it's so important for us to take care in terms of our mental health, because oftentimes what happens in our physical bodies is a reflection of the care or the lack of care that we have taken in our minds and our thoughts. So here we see Elijah, foggy in his thinking, now fatigued in his body. The Bible says that he travels a day's journey into the wilderness. While he's in the wilderness, watch this. He says in verse 4, I have had enough, Lord. Take my life. Woo! Y'all don't miss this, family. Elijah goes from foggy thinking to fatigue in his physical body. Now he goes to flirting with unhealthy thoughts and desires. Look at your neighbor if you got one with you and say, stop flirting. Somebody type that in to the comments. Say, stop flirting. What do you mean? What are you seeing here in the text? The text says that Elijah now began to have suicidal thoughts. Why? Because it's once we've been in the fog that fatigue sets in, and then we begin to flirt with things that we never would have otherwise. Woo! Preach, Pastor Brian. I came to tell somebody, stop flirting. Stop flirting with that idea that you know is not good for you. Stop flirting with those thoughts, those anxious thoughts, those fearful thoughts, those depressive thoughts. Stop flirting with that person who you know God hasn't called you to. Come on, somebody. Stop flirting with that job that you realize is not your calling. Stop flirting with those ideas that are only gonna take you to destruction. Here, Elijah, one of the greatest prophets that ever lived, has gone from hitting his stride to flirting with suicide. The difficulty here, family, is that you and I can all be in that space. We can all be in that place where that which we first thought about in our mind all of a sudden becomes reality before us. Why? Because there are things that we will flirt with in our fatigue that we never would have flirted with in our fitness. Preach, Pastor. There are things that will call our name in moments of fatigue that we would have immediately hit block caller in moments of fitness. But God says, I'm looking for my people to hit their stride. And when they hit their stride, to continue moving at an effective pace that impacts their lives, their families, and even beyond their families for the glory of the Lord. I believe that's what God is speaking to somebody today. God is saying, I've called you my son. I've called you my daughter to hit your stride in this season. I've called you to walk by faith and not by sight. I've called you to hear my voice. I've called you to minister to others in your vicinity, in your community, in your circle of influence. Why? Because that's part of what I put you on this earth to do. And I put you on this earth to hit your stride. I need somebody to declare that over their own life. Even if you don't feel it, even if you don't believe it, I'm about to hit my stride. Elijah gives us a powerful example of what it looks like to hit his stride. But Elijah could only demonstrate for us how to hit our stride. He cannot empower us to actually do it. But what's so interesting, family, is that when we get to the New Testament, we find that Jesus is actually mistaken for Elijah. Ah, come on, Pastor, bring the word. The Bible reminds us that when Jesus Christ asked his disciples, he says, "Who do men say that I am?" And Peter stood up and he said, some say that you are Elijah. Because in biblical prophecy, it was understood by the Jews that Elijah, or the second coming of someone like Elijah, would precede the Messiah. And what Jesus comes to let us know is that, no, I'm not Elijah, but I'm actually the Messiah. Elijah came to give us a picture, but I came to give you the power. Elijah came to give you an example, but I actually came to empower you to live in the way that I've called you to live. Elijah wanted to show you something, but I wanted to put something on the inside of you. I wanted to enable you to live and to hit your stride in this season of life. I listen, family, if you ever go to a race or you see a marathon being run, oftentimes what you will see in that marathon race is you will see people who are all along the sidelines of the race. They're lined up on both sides. And as the runners are coming down, people are handing them bottles of water or bottles of Gatorade. They're handing them those protein bars. Why are they doing that? Because what they recognize is if you are going to make maintain your stride, you need something on the inside of you that strengthens you and that propels you forward. See, when you're running that kind of a race, sometimes somebody can testify that your body gets weary and you begin to slump over and you lose your stride. But when you get something on the inside of you, it enables you to maintain your stride. And here's what I want you to know. Elijah came to give us a picture, but Jesus came to give us the power. What did he do when he died on the cross? He said, I gotta go so I can send the Holy Spirit. He will live inside of you and he will bring back to your remembrance everything that I've taught you. I'm putting something on the inside of you that's gonna help you maintain your stride. And even before he died, Jesus showed us how he lived this thing out, because the Bible says that when he ministered to a woman at a well, after he had ministered to her, that she ran back to her hometown and she began to tell everybody, come and see a man who told me everything I ever did. What did she do, family? She began to hit her stride. The Bible says that there was a man at a pool called Bethesda, and that man had been there for 38 years, but Jesus came and he saw him and he told him, take up your mat and walk. You see, what happened then was he took up his mat and he hit his stride. God wants you and I to know that it's in those moments that we can hit our stride. That's why Isaiah would say, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. What will they do? They will mount up on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. What does that mean, family? That's what it looks like to hit our stride. I declare today that somebody watching this, you are on the verge. You are at the precipice. You are on the brink of hitting your stride and being all that God has called you to be. Don't let this season slow you down. Don't let the racial injustice tear you down to the point that you cannot function. Don't let the pandemic paralyze you, but you got to walk by faith and not by sight and declare, I'm about to hit my stride. I feel that for somebody today. I don't know where you are. I don't know what you're going through, but the Lord says, if you walk by faith and not by sight, you're going to hit your stride. You're going to run and not grow weary. You're going to walk and not be faint. I believe these are God's promises for you and for me. And that if we trust him more, we'll see it. He will fulfill it. We will experience it for his glory and for our good. I pray you receive this word today, family. And you speak over yourself. Maybe you're going to write it somewhere in your home. I'm about to hit my stride. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to hear your word and to be empowered by your word. We thank you, Lord God, that even in the middle, Lord God, of the world slowing down and everything seemingly put on pause, your word still breaks through the darkness, speaks to our hearts, telling us that we're about to hit our stride if we trust in you, if we keep the faith. And so, God, I pray right now that by the power of your Spirit, you would fill us up. Yeah, Lord, fill us up. We need something on the inside of us, just like that marathon runner, that will straighten us up, that will give power to our bones and to our ligaments and to our joints, that will give us spiritual renewal, that we'll be able to hit our stride for the glory of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. My brother, my sister, I pray that as you have heard this word today, that something on the inside of you was jolted, that something on the inside of you was strengthened, was quickened to remind you that you are about to hit your stride. I pray that something was awakened in you in this moment, family, because I believe that even in the middle of all of the turmoil that you're facing, all of the turmoil that our world is going through, God is still speaking. And maybe it is a still small voice. Maybe it's still a faint whisper, but I hear him speaking to your spirit. Deep calls out to deep. He's saying, you are about to hit
your stride. Don't give up now. Don't stop where you are, but continue to press your way forward. I hear that word resounding over and over again, that they that wait upon the Lord, they will renew their strength. God says, I know you're tired. I know you're weary. I know you're worn out, but there is a renewal coming to your strength, and you're going to mount up with wings like eagles, and you will run and not grow weary. These are the promises of the Almighty God for those of us who would trust in Him. So my brother, my sister, don't give up today. Don't throw in the towel. Don't let depression and fear and anxiety weigh you down so much that you're not lifted up by the grace of the Lord. Remember, Jesus came to do what Elijah couldn't do. He came to put something on the inside of you. Elijah gave us a picture, but Jesus said, I come with power. He said that you shall receive power. Yeah, that's what it says in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And I believe, family, for all of you who have placed your faith in Jesus Christ, the Spirit of God is living on the inside of you. And He says today, I need to remind you, just like I did my disciples at the day of Pentecost, that you shall receive power when the Spirit comes upon you. And guess what? Today is the day, because Paul told us to be continually filled with the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God. Yeah, right now, I believe a moment is happening. I believe a time is coming, even where you are, in your home, in your car, in your living room, right there. The Spirit of God is coming to meet you. The Spirit of God is descending upon you in power. He's raising up inside of you like fire, and He's going to give you the strength you need for this season in the name of Jesus. I invite you to lift up your hands and receive it right now. In the name of Jesus. Yeah, yeah. I'm talking to you, my sister, on the verge of giving up. I'm talking to you, my brother, not knowing what the next best step is. God says, I've got power for you. You're about to hit your stride. And I didn't bring you this far to leave you. Yeah, come on, somebody say, I just can't give up now. To talk to yourself. It gives you a moment to encourage yourself. You see, sometimes you just gotta talk to yourself. Sometimes you gotta take a moment when nobody else is around, or maybe they are around, but you gotta disregard them for a moment and talk to yourself. The scriptures declare that David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. You've gotta pause for a moment and say, I just can't give up now. I don't believe that God has brought me this far to leave me. I'm gonna keep pressing. I'm gonna keep pushing. I'm gonna maintain. I'm going to hit my stride, and regardless of the fog, regardless of the fatigue, regardless of the flirtations that may want to come my way, I'm focused on the Almighty God who's got a plan for my life, who's pointing me in a direction that will make an impact in the name of Jesus. Nobody told me that it was going to be easy. But discipline determines my destiny. Nobody told me that it was gonna be easy, but no weapon formed against me is able to prosper. Nobody told me that it was going to be easy, but as long as I move and meditate, as long as I reach and I rest, I'll be able to find the strength that only comes from God. My sister, my brother, God says, He's brought you too far to leave you. And I declare it today, you are about to hit your stride in the name of Jesus. Listen, family, if you're listening to this message today, I want you to know you can only hit your stride in the way I'm discussing, the way we're teaching, by the power of Jesus Christ. That means you got to have a real relationship with Jesus Christ. That means you have to give him your heart and put him on the throne of your life. The Bible says that all of us have sinned and come short of his glory. That all, you know, something about that word all, it means all. It means everybody near you. It means everybody in the house next door. It means everybody in the state next to yours. It means everybody at your job. Everybody you saw on the bus. That all means all. And so all of us have to make a decision to give our lives to the Lord, because we fall short of his glory. We've lied, we've cheated, we've stolen. We haven't been who he's called us to be. But if we confess our sins, the Bible says that he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and purify us of all unrighteousness. So if you're watching today and you've never given your life to the Lord, this is an opportunity to take that step of faith. Say, God, I want to be saved. I want to be connected to the God who made me. I want to hit my stride. Maybe you're watching and you're already saved, but you don't have a church home. And you've been checking us out during quarantine. You've been jumping here and there, but there's something that's drawing you to this church family. My brother, my sister, I want to challenge you that the best way to hit your stride is when you're in community with some other believers. God says he doesn't want you to run by yourself, but he wants you to run with a team that's destined to win. I invite you to get connected to this church family we call Macedonia. Maybe you just need prayer. We're here for you, my brother, my sister, that God might have his way. If you want to give your life to the Lord, if you want to get connected to this church, or you just need prayer, I invite you to call our prayer line. Lines are open right now, 1-800-759-1970, 1-800-759-1970. Somebody is standing by to pray with you. Listen, you can't call too much. Somebody says, well, I called last week. Call again. Somebody's standing to pray with you. Somebody says, well, I've never called. I don't know how they're going to receive me. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of strength. Today is the day of renewal. Call in so that you might be able to hit your stride. Maybe you can't call in this moment, but you want to give your life to the Lord, or you want to get connected. Just type in that word, connect, C-O-N-N-E-C-T, and somebody will reach out to you that you might have all that God has in store for you. In the name of Jesus, that you might be able to declare, I can't give up now.
I just can't give up now.
Said I've come too far. And speak over yourself today and in the days ahead. God did not bring you this far to leave you. He did not bring us this far to leave us. We will remain steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, because we know there is a promise made on our behalf. There's a promise made to us. We will stand firm in this season by the grace of the Almighty God. My brother, my sister, you are about to hit your stride. Thank you for making this church, this worship encounter, the space where you would meet with God, you would hear his voice, and then you would respond to his call. We hope that you'll share this with somebody, let them know that they can tune in, connect with us every weekend, Saturdays at 6 p.m., Sundays at 9, 11, and 1, that God might get the glory out of your life. Would you receive now this blessing? Now may the God of all grace continue to strengthen you, comfort you, and encourage you. May he lift you up out of the muck and the mire. May he restore unto you the joy of your salvation. And may he give you the strength to hit your stride. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. See you next week. He brought me this far.